This video is made possible by The Great Courses Plus, an on-demand video learning service. Learn at your own pace with no tests and no schedules. Check out The Great Courses Plus through the link in the description below. More about them a little later. The American Revolution is one of the historical events that, together with things like the French Revolution, among other things, helped usher in the modern era. Americans, on the whole, tend to be proud of this event and focus on it heavily in their school curriculum, as it heralds the birth of their nation and the triumph of a handful of terrorists against their government and fellow countrymen. But what do schools in Britain have to say about the American Revolution? To begin with, on the surface, if one talks to people on the street or reads a British book on the subject, Americans will perhaps be positively surprised to see that today there are no hard feelings in England regarding the Americans' choice to leave the glorious British Empire. May it reign forever. But really, we don't care. It seems like a peachy divorce with no grudges held or hostile views taken. After all, for the last century at least, the UK has been the closest ally of the US in Europe, with mutual support in all major conflicts of the 20th century, and both follow similar policies so consistently that the UK has, on occasion, been ironically referred to as the 52nd state. But there is a catch. While the American Revolution is a cornerstone of American history, in Britain, well, it seems that the subject of the American War of Independence, as it is known in the UK, is rarely mentioned in British education books of past and present, or at least not in any great detail. That's not to say it's not mentioned anywhere, simply that while they may learn a little about early American history, including the War of Independence, it's more of a footnote in British history. It's probably also worth mentioning that when it is mentioned, it is never seen from a nationalistic point of view. For example, we don't angrily shake our fists at a picture of Thomas Jefferson and Benjamin Franklin. Rather, it's covered frankly, and then we move on swiftly to more interesting and relevant subjects to British history. For example, the focus in history is much more centered around things like the Roman times, for example, the legendary resistance of Queen Boudicca against the might of Rome, or later periods, such as the Hundred Years' War and the intrigues of the Tudors generally trying to keep track of all the beheadings in the Tower of London. In more modern times, emphasis is put on issues such as industrialization, colonialism, and the post-colonization era, as well as the events during the World Wars and internal reforms. As to the aggression of the British Empire, while many certainly complain that it's not fully represented, it is far from omitted. British imperialism, for example, in Africa, is of course addressed. So why not focus on the American War of Independence and the birth of one of the most influential nations in modern history? It seems that the lack of details when teaching about American independence is not due to shame, envy, or part of a continuous effort to hide the UK's colonial past, as, say, the case might be in Japan. Rather, the main reason is the unspectacularly trivial fact that the American Revolution is seen as a minor detail in comparison to other events directly related to British history. The US breaking off was simply just one of many nations that did it for a whole lot of reasons. Indeed, if one looks at the larger scope, more than 60 countries celebrate independence from the British Empire, which in its heyday had control over one-fifth of the globe's population. That would amount to, on average, one Independence Day celebration of a country every week in a given school year. A phlegmatic English answer would be to say that we have better things to focus on than every country's Independence Day. So, the American Revolution is equated with other similar events, and it is rather addressed as an armed uprising of an important but distant rural populace against taxes, so hardly unique in history. The importance of ideas such as enlightenment, freedom, and democratic values are viewed by Americans on the basis of their revolution as one prime example thereof. But the schools in the UK, similar to most European countries, focus on other incidents. Some of them are closer to home and widely acknowledged as shaping history, such as the French Revolution. Another example is the post-colonialism era in Asia and Africa as one of the main facets of world history. These, rather than American independence, are considered to provide the historical depth necessary for such discussions in the UK classrooms. Thus, the War of American Independence will most likely come up as an addendum, providing context when dealing with the French Revolution or with trade regulations within the British Empire as an example of a taxation policy gone wrong. It can also be related to the long-term effects of the Seven Years' War, which may be considered one of the causes that would eventually lead to the higher taxation that in turn ignited the revolutionary actions in the Americas. Of course, that does not mean that American history is shunned from British schools, far from it. The developments of civic rights, the role of American industrialization, the combined efforts with the British in the World Wars and the Cold War are placed highly in various stages of the curriculum, be it in the early key stages of the English system or adapted for older students of 15 to 18 years, such as during the A-level and GCSE exams. To give an example within the history books provided by AQA, that's a blast from the past, out of more than 30 titles covering the period from the Crusades up to the 21st century, two refer directly to the USA. The Making of a Superpower, USA, 1865 to 1975, and The American Dream, Reality and Illusion, 1945 to 1980. The titles are indicative of the thematic stressed in each book. Notice that there is no book specifically dealing with the USA before 1861. Besides these reasons, the lack of emphasis on the American Revolution could be seen as related to the political scene within the UK itself. The UK is regarded by some as a fragile nation, as emphasized by much talk of independence by individual regions, especially in the last decade. The independence of a mainly English-speaking American colony, which is also culturally related to England, is much more on par with the Scottish or North Irish independence movements than, say, the Indian independence of 1947. But to sum up, in general, the American Revolution is not negatively portrayed in British schools, as some might first assume. Rather, it is seen as one of many world history events which are linked to the understanding and teaching of UK history without being particularly vital to it, and thus not really worth covering in depth. And I'll just add on a personal note here that when we started doing this series of How Is So-and-So Taught in Another Part of the World, someone asked me this on Twitter, and my response is just, it's just not taught. We don't really look at it. And well, now you've had the more in-depth answer. And you know what else is worth covering in-depth? Literally every subject available from our friends at The Great Courses Plus, which is an on-demand library of wonderful courses that'll help you get all kinds of wicked smart, like those rabble-rousing colonial Americans. No, really, we don't mind. If you're enjoying this video, I think you'll really enjoy their course on the Age of Benjamin Franklin. Or if you want to zoom out a little bit, maybe check out their broader course, A History of the United States, Second Edition. That one's absolutely massive. It's an 84-part exploration of American history, and those 84 parts, they're like half an hour each, so that's not a joke. Basically, The Great Courses Plus is like a university education, but it's at your own pace. No tests, no schedules, and it's incredibly easy to access, PC, tablet, phone. They've also got audio streaming, very convenient, so you can learn and listen, or listen and learn, on the move. There are thousands of lectures to choose from, so it's great stuff. Try it out for free at thegreatcoursesplus.com/brainfood, or click the link in the description below, and let's get into today's bonus fact. Ever wonder what the difference between the UK, England, and Great Britain is? Honestly, yes, sometimes even as a British man. The actual name of the sovereign state we are talking about here is the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland, the UK. The United Kingdom is made up of the countries England, Scotland, Wales, and Northern Ireland. The confusion of the terms seems to revolve around the term country and the political powers that are perceived based on that word. While the four countries that make up the UK are generally considered separate in the minds of locals and in certain sporting events, their powers for local law and control are devolved from the UK. Think of the 50 states of the United States. While each state has their own set of laws, they are all under the power of the federal government. In the case of the UK, it is somewhat similar, though certain responsibilities are also implied, like healthcare and education, that are delegated to three of the four countries. The responsibilities that are delegated differ from one country to the next. England is the only country in which the UK does not devolve any powers, and instead it is legislated directly by the UK government. When it comes to international politics, it is the sovereign nation of the UK that is recognised, and not any of the four constituent countries. The term Great Britain refers to the landmass that comprises England, Scotland, and Wales. Something that aids in the confusion as to the difference between Great Britain and the UK is that the term is sometimes internationally used as a synonym for the UK. For instance, the UK's Olympic team competes under the name Great Britain, and the ISO, International Organization for Standardization, gives the UK the country codes of GB and GDR. This can be confusing, given that the ISO also codes England, Scotland, and Wales as subdivision countries of the UK, but Northern Ireland as a subdivision province. If you're getting the impression that Northern Ireland is the red-headed stepchild of the UK, you may be right, both figuratively and literally, we suppose. The confusion over the definition of these four countries in reference to the UK is further muddied up in sporting competitions. There are several international sporting events like the Commonwealth Games and football competitions in which each of the four has their own team and they do not compete under a unified national team. When competing under these conditions, their nations are referred to as home nations. Because each team is from a specific home country, it can lead some to think that these countries have political autonomy as well. If you're curious about when these unions between the countries that comprise the UK came about, it happened as follows. England and Wales were joined in 1536. Scotland and England were joined together in 1707, along with the previously joined Wales, to officially form the Kingdom of Great Britain. Ireland decided to join up in 1801, at which point the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Ireland was formed. In 1922, however, many of the southern counties of Ireland decided to remove themselves from the Union, and the UK changed their name to the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland. So, in summary, Great Britain is England, Scotland, and Wales. The UK is England, Scotland, Wales, and Northern Ireland, and the full name is the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland. England is just the part of the island that is England. So I really hope you enjoyed that video. If you did, check out our great sponsor, The Great Courses Plus, link below, and thank you for watching.